Hey everyone, Todd here. This is going to be a slight departure from the other type of videos that I do. It's still based on a health topic, as health is really near and dear to my heart, but this is more about health misinformation. Health misinformation on the internet, specifically related to this drug ivermectin and its ability to prevent and treat COVID-19. Let me just say, I think that the best health decisions are based on facts. They're not based on assumptions, fears, wishes, conspiracies or alleged conspiracies, misinformation, or unfortunately flat out lies. I think you need to, and we need to, look at the best facts available at the time and make decisions based on facts. How do you know in a health matter what is fact or fiction? Well, you go to a doctor. Specifically, you look at the opinion of specialists in the health field that you're interested in. And why do I say that? Because medicine these days is very complicated, and there are a lot of specialties, and these specialists, they spend more time than a generalist to understand a particular therapy or a particular part of the body. So if you're looking for the best health advice, we want to look to health professionals, doctors, and specialists. Now, the thing is, doctors are human too. And doctors make mistakes, and specialists make mistakes. I'm a case in point. I had two doctors tell me I had Bell's palsy. Two doctors, two independent doctors, two different doctors, two different clinics, tell me I had Bell's palsy. Even when I said I was losing hearing in one ear, and my face was drooping, and my left leg was going numb, and they gave me the wrong diagnosis. They flat out got it wrong, and they were doctors. It wasn't until I went to specialists that deal with the brain and nerves, and then I got the correct diagnosis and treatment. So what do you do if you're looking for information and a doctor gives you one piece of information and another doctor gives you another piece of information? I am all for healthy skepticism. Keep asking questions until you figure that you're getting the majority opinion, right? Look for the consensus among the experts. Does that mean that the majority is going to get it right every time? In an absolute sense, probably not. But it's better than going to the minority, right? Logic dictates that if you've got 100 specialists in the room and 88 of them believe a certain treatment should follow a certain way and 12 don't, that you're more likely to find the correct answer with the 88. It's just the way it is. You will always find somebody with a dissenting opinion. And in cases of people talking heads on the internet, the dissenting opinions can often not be met with studies or facts or anything to back it up other than maybe anecdotal evidence at best, or just take my word for it at worst. So we're going to get into this topic of ivermectin as a treatment and prevention for COVID-19. And the reason why this is near and dear to my heart lately is because I have a family member who, you know, was swayed by the opinion of a doctor on the internet who actually doesn't know exactly what he's talking about. And I'm about to lay it out for you so that none of you fall for the same misinformation on the internet. So what is ivermectin? Ivermectin is a medicine used in veterinary medicine and human medicine to treat parasitic infections, to treat parasites, and as a topical to treat things like scabies or head lice. So it's been in use for, I think, about 40 or 50 years. And at the start of the pandemic, around March, as they were looking for therapies to treat COVID patients, ivermectin, you know, got on the radar, as did hundreds of other compounds and drugs. You may have heard of hydroxychloroquine, one of many that we thought might have some potential to help in treating COVID outcomes. And, You know, studies show that it didn't end up working. Ivermectin is no different. We need studies to find out whether this works. Now, here's where the misinformation comes in. So I'm going to quote from a video, I think some dark horse group did a podcast or a vlog. And a doctor that was on there, what was his name? Dr. Pierre Corey makes these statements, which with 3 minutes of searching, you can find out that they're at best inaccurate and at worst completely wrong. So let's get into it. So the Dr. Corey points out that there was a French long-term care facility with seniors, people who are like in their 90s living there, that at the outbreak of the pandemic in March, there was a scabies outbreak, and which is a skin condition, and they gave everybody in the healthcare in the care home, ivermectin to treat the scabies. Just so happens, the pandemic was raging in France at the time, and they looked at a number of care homes in the area, and found that in the care homes in the surrounding area that were similar to this one where everyone got ivermectin, people were getting COVID at like a 22% rate, and they were going to hospital and or dying at almost a 5% rate. But in the care home where people got ivermectin, I think it was like 1% got sick, and nobody died and nobody went to the hospital. And in this podcast/vlog, they go at great lengths to say, isn't it amazing? People got ivermectin. They didn't get COVID, or very few of them got COVID. Nobody went to the hospital. Nobody died. Ergo, ivermectin prevents and or treats COVID-19, and I don't know why nobody's talking about it. Sounds amazing, right? Till you go to the study that they're quoting, and the actual authors of the study, the people that did the study, did not come to that conclusion. In fact, the authors of the study themselves conclude that while there is something promising or something interesting in what happened with ivermectin and COVID outcomes in this case, it warrants more study. They cannot conclude from this study that you can take ivermectin to prevent and or treat COVID-19 symptoms. They point out that the study itself was flawed in many, many, many ways. They call them confounding variables, things that that weren't accounted for in the study that might skew the results. So bottom line is, we don't know. From that one study, we don't know whether ivermectin is effective or not. But you've got doctors on video telling you that it is, quoting the study I just talked to you about, and giving you an outcome that was not in the study. So they either were completely misinformed about the outcome of the study, or they're just lying to you about what the outcome was. Because I'll tell you right now, that was not the conclusion of the study, that ivermectin was effective. It seemed like it was, but it was not effective. Or it was not proven to be effective because the study was majorly flawed. More study needs to be done. Second thing that the doctor says is, we're not giving patients enough corticosteroids. When they have COVID symptoms, they're getting a certain small amount of corticosteroids for 10 days. And in this doctor's opinion, that's a travesty, that they should be getting much, much higher doses of corticosteroid and for much, much longer amounts of time. And the host is just, you know, so outraged. Why are we not studying this? Why did they come to this conclusion? Oh, no. They did studies on the amount of corticosteroid to give people. They found that this amount of corticosteroid over this length was beneficial. I looked into further studies where they studied higher amounts of the corticosteroid and for longer periods of time, and they didn't come to any different conclusion. So for these doctors to say in my practice, I do X, which is different than Y, and I see better outcomes. It's just he said, she said, they said. It's, you need to have studies to prove whether or not what you're saying is true or not. It doesn't mean that you might not be right, right? It doesn't mean that in your practice or in your experience, you didn't have a better outcome. What it means is we can't prove that your experience can be replicated. We don't know why you had your experience. And you can't make a health decision based on a sample size of one. You really can't. So there's another example of misinformation, a doctor on the internet telling you this is the way it is. And when you look into the studies that hundreds and thousands of other people have done and they don't come to that same conclusion, who are you going to believe? The thousands of people who've tried what you say works and doesn't work, or just the person that says it works? Anyway, could keep going on here. The guest kept talking about how he'd written many, many papers. The implication being, I've written papers, I know what I'm talking about, you should just believe what I have to say. That's not the way it works. Sorry. He also said, I wrote a paper with a world-renowned specialist. Well, what he doesn't tell you is the world-renowned specialist that he wrote the paper with is an X-ray radiologist, right? So he's a specialist in reading the images of X-rays, MRIs, other various scans. Hey, and I'll just assume, yeah, he's a world expert at reading images. Does that make that person an expert at levels of corticosteroid or ivermectin to give to people to save them from COVID-19? It just doesn't follow, right? It's this argument, which is, I'm an expert, I associate with experts, I've written papers with experts, therefore, what I'm telling you is just true. Almost like it doesn't need study, because I've done it, everyone should just believe me. That's just not the way it works. Another comment that the doctor and this host made was that in the US, there is more corruption and more, tools of corruption or ways to benefit from corruption than anywhere else in the world. And I don't know what your opinion is watching this, but that's unsubstantiated. It might be true. It might not be true. The question, the reality is we don't know if that's true. How can you make a statement that says, my country is more corrupt than any other country in the world, therefore, people that make vaccines for COVID-19 are corrupt, and they're making money, and corrupted political people are pushing their agenda. You know, like, see how it just flows into, since we are so corrupt, then people that don't do what I say is true, they're corrupt. And it's not substantiated. How do you make, anyway, you can't make claims like that without giving some sort of evidence, some sort of proof that what you're saying is true. These doctor and this host of this vlog were frustrated that the mainstream media was not giving them their due. That every time they go to CNN or talk to like a major newspaper, they always pit them as if they're the minority against the majority. They are the minority. They are the minority. So they're the 12 doctors saying the 88 other doctors are wrong. And when the media outlets, you know, kind of ask them, well, where's the proof that you're correct and those 88 are incorrect, and they offer no proof, they're frustrated by that. Why don't they just believe us? Right? We're experts. I've written papers. I'm a doctor. It's really crazy to think that someone can believe that by being in the minority that somehow qualifies them as having the truth. They might be right. Please hear me. I don't know whether or not ivermectin helps people, not get COVID, or if they get sick from it, it helps you recover faster. I don't know, but they don't either. That's the whole point. They don't either, because the studies don't show that. There may be a study that seems to show that, but as I've already pointed out in the beginning, one of the studies that they quote actually concluded that they had a different conclusion than what they said. So I don't know what to tell you. If someone completely misinterprets and or misinforms you about the conclusion of a study, are they more or less likely to misinform you about any other study they talk about? I don't know. It casts doubt on the whole thing, though. I find it interesting that one of the makers of ivermectin, Merck, I think that worldwide they go by the company name MSD, they themselves in February of this year, 2021, came up with a statement that they reviewed all of the studies done on ivermectin to date, and they found that none of the studies showed efficacy in treating COVID and questionable safety as well. Other studies have shown that there are a variety of side effects to ivermectin treatment. They don't seem all that terrible from what I looked up, but there definitely are some potential side effects to using the drug. They haven't studied it in anyone over 65 years old, at least the studies I was able to find. It didn't look like they had enough information to comment on side effects on those over 65. But the claim from the doctor and his host on the YouTube said there's no side effects to ivermectin. That's not true. And who am I? I'm not a researcher, but I've gone to PubMed. I've pulled up articles from Lancet, from the peer-reviewed journals themselves. You can read the studies, and right in there, they list the side effects and whether they were mild, moderate, severe, and whether they were likely, common, or rare. It's right there. So to say there are no side effects is not in keeping with the research. I'm sorry. So there's another piece of misinformation that there's no side effects to this drug. That's just not true. And listen, other national health bodies have studied this subject. The major European health body concluded that of all the trials that have been done on ivermectin, they showed no efficacy or potential efficacy, and that more trials needed to be done. So they're not saying it doesn't work. They're saying they don't know if it works, right? So more trials need to be done. On YouTube, the podcast I'm talking about, the host and the doctor were complaining that nobody listens to them, that they're being suppressed. Well, that's true. They were suppressed in a sense that one of the doctor's videos got removed from YouTube, where he testified in front of the Senate or Congress. And in that interview, he made statements that were flat out wrong. He made statements that if you take ivermectin, you will be cured. Well, you can't say that. He said it, and you can't say that. So they had to take the video down for that reason. So yeah, you're being suppressed for saying things that aren't true. Is it possible ivermectin works and does things? Yes. Has it been demonstrated? No. Why would you take a medicine that has not been demonstrated to show efficacy or safety? I don't know. It's irresponsible and or dangerous for anyone to do that. Like, anyone can make a podcast, anyone can do a vlog, anyone can go on YouTube. It doesn't mean that what they say is true. So when it comes to this topic, I'm just warning everybody out there, do your research, look at the studies, find out what the experts are saying, and then weigh. Are you taking the opinion of a minority of people, or are you taking the opinion of a majority of people? One is logical and more safe. One is not logical and potentially unsafe. So you have to kind of weigh the balance of the evidence. I don't know what happened to the whole skepticism that used to surround the internet. When the internet first came out, anybody could say anything on any webpage that they wanted to, and we would make fun of people for believing whatever anybody said because it was on the internet. Right? We used to have this, oh, it's on the internet, it must be true. It's just not the case. Anybody can have passion and belief and have credentials and tell you that this is true. You've got to really do your homework and figure out if what they're saying is right before you just take their word for it when it comes to your health. All right, I'll leave you with this final funny story. When I was young, we came back to find my grandpa crying at his apartment, and we thought something was terribly wrong with him. We said, "Grandpa, what's wrong?" And he said, "I read something in the newspaper that is so awful, and I just feel sick, and it's just so awful." And we said, "Oh my, what happened? What'd you read in the newspaper?" He said, "A woman gave birth to a baby goat, and there were pictures, and it was awful, and I don't know what the world has come to. How can a woman give birth to a baby goat?" And he was crying, and we're like, "A woman gave birth to a goat? That's not true." So we found the paper. It was the National Enquirer, right? So National Enquirer has a fake story, and it looked realistic. I mean, the only reason why you know instantly it's wrong is it's the National Enquirer, and women don't give birth to baby goats, right? But the article was written very matter-of-factly, had a picture of the birth, had a picture of the goat, and my grandpa, being naive, grew up in an era where what was written in paper, what was written in the paper, on paper, was true. No one lied in the news. That was true. Well, now we have good old internet where people can speak with authority and passion and flash their credentials and tell you about something that happened in another country and you just take their word for it. I wouldn't. You can if you want to. I would. So Google ivermectin if you're curious. There's a ton of stuff out there on that. I barely scratched the surface on this thing. I was more concerned about misinformation on the internet, and it frustrates me when so-called experts get on there and convincingly tell somebody the way things are, and it turns out with just a little bit of research, it's not the way things are. And there are people, like a person in my family, who are following the health advice of someone that they don't know, who's actually giving misinformation on the internet. It's dangerous, dangerous, dangerous stuff. Don't fall victim. Thanks for watching. Peace out.